Bonjour, I'm Michel Legrand. You're listening to The Music Never Ends here on BBC Radio 2. I knew when I was young and studying that I wanted to try to do everything possible in music. Everything. Music is the only thing I know.
The Music Never Ends. The Michel Legrand Story. As told by David Jacobs.
Hello there. I'm David Jacobs. Over the next 6 weeks, I'll be telling the story of a remarkable man and his music, the multi-Oscar-winning composer, pianist, performer, and arranger, Michel Legrand.
When I think of Michel Legrand, I think of creativeness.
Singer Tony Bennett.
He creates. He's not a cookie cutter, you know. He's not doing what everybody else does. He comes up with something completely original.
He's quick.
Film director Norman Jewison.
His inspiration comes very fast and seems to have no exhaustion to it. I mean, I'm just shocked when I hear he's done 200 scores. I had no idea he'd done that much.
Author and lecturer at the University of Southern California, John Burlingame.
Michel Legrand is a true original. I don't think we have ever seen an artist quite like him, for a number of reasons. He's a composer, arranger, a conductor, a pianist, and he's extremely skilled in each one of those disciplines. I think that as a composer, he is truly unique.
American vocalist Sue Rainey.
He's a great jazz scat person on stage. He sings wonderfully. It is unusual to find a person who can do all of those things. He knows that. Because I think he has a lot of pride in what he's been able to accomplish, and he should have.
Lyricist Sheldon Harnick.
Michel is just endlessly fertile. Music just pours out of him. He's pure music.
Broadway musical director Todd Ellison.
I think Michel is very well versed in all aspects of the music business. He does know instrumentation. He has studied all those instruments. In orchestra rehearsal, he'd be telling the bass player how he wanted it played, or the percussionist, no. Don't use those sticks. Let's try the snare drum sticks on the xylophone, just to get a different effect.
In this series, we'll be hearing from his friends and admirers. And in an exclusive interview, Michel Legrand tells his own story, a journey that took him from the streets of Paris to the studios of Hollywood and the jazz clubs of New York. A career that spans 6 decades and encounters with Barbra Streisand, Oscar Peterson, and Henry Mancini. Hank's widow, Ginny Mancini.
When I hear the name Michel Legrand, I think of a French leprechaun. Je t'aime, Michel. Or Michel, sorry about that.
Mi, ré, mi, do, mi, si, mi, la, mi, sol, mi, fa, fa, mi, fa, ré, fa, do, fa, si, fa, la, fa, si, la, si, sol, si, fa, si, mi, si.
Michel Legrand has kept the music playing nearly 70 years. He's recorded over 100 albums, composed for the Broadway stage, and even found time to direct a couple of films. But tonight, on The Music Never Ends, Michel remembers the teacher who taught him as much about life as music. And he recalls 2 albums, one that celebrated his home of Paris, the other that cemented his lifelong love affair with jazz.
When I write something, I do it with my blood. I mean, even if it's a tiny little song or anything, you know, I give all my life. When there is 500 grams needed to write something, I always bring 10 tons instead.
As we'll hear in this series, Legrand is the master of melody, and his compositions have found fame through performances by such greats as Frank Sinatra and Dusty Springfield, Grady Tate and Lena Horne. But perhaps he's best known for composing the scores for The Thomas Crown Affair and The Summer of 42.
I don't know him through his movie scores, not really at all.
Legendary jazz bass player Ron Carter.
I just know him through songs Grady would sing, or maybe Shirley Horn would sing, or Tony Bennett would sing.
How do you keep the music playing? How do you make it last? How a song from fading too fast. How do you lose yourself to someone and never lose your way? How do you not run out of new things to say?
Broadway director James Lapine.
Michel, of course, because he doesn't write lyrics, is working a lot off the words sometimes, but mostly I would say Michel works off emotion. And what I love about his music and what I love about working with him, because this music is him, is he's full of life, he's full of emotion, and, you know, that makes you full of life and full of emotion to be in a room with. And
in the music business, three people come to mind: Michel Legrand, Leonard Bernstein, and Andre Previn.
Record producer and conductor Ettore Strata.
All three important because they were musicians, and they were able to do everything. They would conduct, play, compose, yeah, at the best. When I think of Michel Legrand, I think of the word genius.
I don't think he's a genius. I think he's an enormously talented person.
Jazz pianist Terry Trotter.
Bach was a genius. Michel Legrand is not at that level.
Maybe not, but for many, Legrand's success lies in his versatility. Ron Carter, and first, Sheldon Harnick.
He can do anything. When you collaborate with Michel, he is a master of all styles.
People feel Michel is a jack of all trades. And he's known primarily as a film composer and a writer of popular songs, lyrics by Alan and Marilyn Bergman. That seems to be the way the general public knows him.
Indeed, Legrand and the Bergmans have been collaborators for over 35 years. As we'll hear in this series, Marilyn and Alan know more about Michel than most.
Unlike many composers, Michel Legrand writes every single day.
And he practices the piano every single day. Yeah. And he's thinking about music every moment. I mean, he gets a look in his eye, and we know it well, and we can be anywhere doing anything, and I know that he's writing something. He's hearing something.
Did you talk about his fingers never stop moving? So he writes every day. So that motor is running all the time.
And always up to speed, you know? It's the music. I mean, when you talk about the music, you're talking about the man.
Like a tunnel that you follow to a tunnel of its own. Down a hollow to a cavern where the sun has never shone. Like a door that keeps revolving in a half-forgotten dream. Or the ripples from a pebble someone tosses in a stream. Like a clock whose hands are sweeping past the minutes of its face. And the world is like an apple whirling silently in space. Like the circles that you find in the windmills of your mind.
One of the most successful Legrand Bergman compositions, The Windmills of Your Mind. Born in Paris in 1932, Michel Legrand's early years were solitary and his childhood an unhappy one.
When I was 3 years old, I had a little older sister who went to school. My mother was alone because my father went away a few months before and stayed away. I mean, he came back. My mother had to work. So I was alone in that, with, you know, a grandmother who knew nothing about anything. A sweet, lovely woman, but fortunately, my father, who was a musician, was a good orchestrator, good arranger. Before he left my mother, he forgot to take an old piano at home. This piano saved me, really saved me. And I was listening to the radio, to the songs that I heard on radio. And then after that, at 3 years old, was one figure I tried to find the melody, you know, on the keyboard that I just heard. And not only I started to find the melody, but I also found the chords underneath, you know. So I spent all my days doing that from morning to night. I hated the world around me. I always refused to go to school because to school you are among other little boys, and the boys are ridiculous. They would just want to punch you on the nose. I mean, you know, they want to kill you. I mean, it's a cruel world. So I lived my childhood absolutely alone. And then when I was 9 and a half years old, I mean, because I started to study so early. So at 9 and a half, I was very much advanced compared to other people. So I was really ready to enter the conservatoire.
The Paris Conservatoire was the leading musical establishment in France.
Jazz critic for the Times, Alan Shipton.
If you were anyone and you wanted to get on in your career, that's where you went to study. All kinds of people, going right back to Debussy and Ravel, had connections with the place.
And when I entered that world, suddenly I discovered, you know, one day, that's my family, that's my only family. And then I started to enjoy people, I started to start to like people, because they were all musicians. Everything we did was music, everything we spoke about, nothing else. And suddenly I said, that's my home, that's me, it's really me.
He must have been very, very talented to be taken on.
My harmony teacher was Henri Chaland. He said to me one day, you know, when I was about 12, he said, Michel, you should work with Nadia Boulanger. I didn't know who she was.
She ran masterclasses in most of the world's leading academies, teaching composition, teaching ensembles, teaching people how to play and perform, and it was her ability to spot the particular thing in a student that would advance their career and make them develop as a musician.
And so I met a lady. She said, sit down, my little boy. So play me this and that. So she tried me. And she said to my teacher, she said, yes, give him to me now. And I entered Nadia Boulanger composition class.
Ettore Estrada again.
The school of musician in Europe is much more refined than in other parts. And Michel Legrand, particularly being at the Paris Conservatoire and studying with Nadia Boulanger, acquired a great understanding of the musical palette, the language, the orchestration.
I'm the kind of a singer that I cannot sing unless I hear beautiful chords.
International recording artist Jack Jones.
I have to hear that beauty, and I expect it. And Michel Legrand is the epitome of use of every note in the spectrum.
Blue, oh, your eyes were blue. Like I've never seen. My eyes were all they knew. Then they turned. Then they turned green.
Sheldon Harnick again.
He is a trained musician. He was one of Nadia Boulanger's students, and I think, like many of her students, she was furious at him when he didn't become a symphonic composer.
There were several things that made Nadia Boulanger quite difficult to work with.
Alan Shipton.
First of all, she was unforgiving. She wanted you to excel at everything. And secondly, she could be quite cussedly difficult. I mean, she wanted to push people slightly beyond their limits all the time.
This is the kind of person she was. So you love her as much as you hate her. I mean, extraordinary, extraordinary person. She taught music, but she taught everything. She taught life. She knew everyone in Paris. And She was a very close friend with Igor Stravinsky. So when Igor Stravinsky came to Paris to conduct his works, instead of doing the class at the conservatoire, Nadia Boulanger brought all of us at the rehearsal of Stravinsky conducting his own work. She said, "I have a little confidence to tell you, my boy," he said to me. "When you are a real composer, you don't know very well what you're doing." Suddenly, the world started to open up. I quit the class right away the next morning. Because, you know, I think that I always felt that we are in the middle of a contradiction of wanting to create, and at the same time, we have the other ourselves, who is a critic, who says, "No, come on, you're not going to write that."
Michel Legrand studied at the Conservatoire for just over 12 years, but upon leaving, he found it difficult to make a living as a classical pianist, instead finding work initially as an accompanist for many of France's top vocalists.
I started to make their orchestrations for records, and my first instrumental solo as a conductor, as an arranger, was I Love Paris. I Love Paris was commissioned by the Columbia Records in New York. So they said, you know, the Columbia Records wants to have a sort of mood album, ambiance album about Paris. And I said, "Yes, but why me?" They said, "Because I was nobody." They asked everyone in New York, like Percy Faith, André Costellanets, and all those, you know, big arrangers with big names. And they all refused. So he said to me, "There is only $200 flat fee for you, and no royalties." So I said, "That's fine," because first of all, I didn't know anything about royalties whatsoever. And also, it was the first time, you know, my first, so I had a chance to do it. So I recorded it, and they gave me all the titles they want. You know, the Cole Porter, I Love Paris, plus many, you know, French songs known in America and everything. Was the beginning of the long playing album, just, you know, just after the famous 78. So for the first time, there was 20 minutes on face A and 20 minutes on face B. So suddenly we had 40 minutes. Stereo didn't exist yet, it was only mono. So they had one microphone in the studio above the orchestra. That's it. So my recording went very fast. Nobody could say, "Oh, we don't hear the flute, we don't hear the oboe," I mean, you know, because it was really like a concert hall. And my huge surprise in New York, they sold, I mean, millions of albums, you know, in no time. It had been a huge hit. Right after I recorded I Love Paris, I became Maurice Chevalier musical director. And then Maurice Chevalier was asked to go to New York to do an hour special on NBC television. It was my first time in New York. I fell in love so much with that town because Bird Lang, you know, the jazz club existed. And every night I was there listening to Miles Davis, to Coltrane, to the High Lows, to Stan Getz. So I said, "That's my town."
And New York would play a major part in the life of Legrand. While he was in town back in 1957, Columbia Records threw a party for the young musician and offered him an opportunity he couldn't refuse. Alan Shipton again.
Very unusually, Columbia came to him and said, "Look, you've had a great success for us. We want you in the catalogue. What would you like to do? And we'll pay you a proper royalty for it."
So I said, "Geez." So I said, "I want to do a jazz album with Miles Davis." Because, you know, every night I was in the club, Miles Davis, Coltrane, Gates. I mean, I want everyone to... He said, "Fine."
Nobody could have predicted that Legrand Jazz was going to be the success it became, still in catalogue, nearly half a century later. Le Grand Jazz is an extraordinary album in lots of ways, but mainly because it shows three very different sorts of musical personality. There are three groups on the album, and Le Grand has always had this ability to hear a band sounding very different from the usual ensemble, or at least to think what to do to it to make it change its sound. The thing that jazz fans love most about the album, though, is that at the time that Miles Davis was getting his great sextet together with John Coltrane on tenor sax and Bill Evans on piano, half that band was pulled into this extraordinary session by Michel Legrand with the great Phil Woods on alto sax. So suddenly you have not just an album which has some big band tracks and some very unorthodox voicings on the small group with Ben Webster, but it has an eight-piece band that is really completely unusual with some of the great voices in modern jazz. So it's a landmark for jazz fans because it shows their heroes in a very different setting from usual.
Le Grand Jazz was recorded over 3 days at the end of June 1958 in New York. Bassist Ron Carter again.
You could tell the general public that he made a record with Phil Woods and Randy Brecker, man. They'd say, what's he doing with those guys? He belongs MGM Studio. So his reputation as the jazz environment is not as widely known as his environment for a film composer and writer of popular melodies.
For Le Grand, the album allowed him to demonstrate his strong attraction to jazz and also gave him the chance to work with his hero, legendary trumpeter Miles Davis.
I was not, you know, scared to work with Miles Davis and those giants. I was petrified. And my friends instead told me, say, careful with Miles, because Miles, the way he behaves is this, they all tell me. He comes to the studio 15 minutes late on purpose. He opens the door of the studio and he stays outside listening to the rehearsal. If he likes it, he comes in, he takes his chair, and he opens his trumpet case, and he starts to work. If he doesn't like it, he just walk out, close the door, and you never see him again. I was petrified. And then that's exactly what happened. And after the first take, he came to me and he said, Michel, you know, because he has his voice, right? He said, Michel, did you like the way I played it? So I said, Miles, it's not that, I cannot tell you how to play your instrument. I mean, you know, you are the Miles. So he said, no, he said, that's your music. You have to tell me how you want me to play it. And I was so thrilled, happy, you know, sweating, but almost crying too. This is what happened. My first jazz album, I did it with Miles. And his last jazz album, he did it with me. So it's a way of, sadly, but a way of looping the loop, I mean, you know, with that giant whom I loved so dearly.
Next week on The Music Never Ends, despite his recording success, Le Grand returns to Paris for a completely new opportunity.
When I write a film, they're asking me to score. And it's true that I did more than 200 films in my life. Every time I find something different. Every time. The only fear in my life is to get bored.
And we remember the film that not only reinterpreted the screen musical, it changed Le Grand's life forever.
People were talking about that film. It was the concept, I think. No one had ever seen a movie like this.
The clock will tick away the hours one by one. And then the time will come when all the waiting's done. The time when you return and find me here and run. Straight
I'm David Jacobs.
If it takes forever, I will wait for you for a thousand summers. I will wait for you till you're back beside me, till I'm holding you, till I hear you sigh here in my arms. Anywhere you wander, anywhere you go, every day remember how I love you so. In your heart, you gotta believe me. What in my
Music Never Ends, The Michel Legrand Story, was written and produced by Malcolm Prince.
Bonjour, I'm Michel Legrand. You're listening to The Music Never Ends here on BBC Radio 2. I never played anything safe. For me, I don't put any importance in success.
The Music Never Ends. The Michel Legrand Story. As told by David Jacobs.
Hello there, I'm David Jacobs. In this series, I'm telling the story of a remarkable man and his music, the multi-Oscar-winning composer, pianist, performer, and arranger, Michel Legrand.
I think what makes me continue and work and stay alive is I want to go as far as possible. I want to try everything. So this is why, you know, every movie, for instance, I scored in my life, I always wanted to try something different, something original. I mean, I want to surprise myself. Because when I do something that I would expect, bores me.
I think when Legrand came on the scene in the mid-1960s, people stood at attention.
Author of Sound and Vision, 60 years of motion picture soundtracks, John Burlingame.
People woke up and listened much more carefully, because this was a sound I don't think that most people had heard before. We were shifting from a traditional sort of 19th century symphonic sound as brought by Alfred Newman and Max Steiner and Eric Korngold, and we were shifting into a more open, a more jazz-oriented, and a more light pop-oriented sound.
Le moteur cliquait encore un peu à froid, mais c'est normal. Merci, merci.
Tonight on The Music Never Ends, Legrand begins his journey to Hollywood via the French ports of Rochefort and Cherbourg with the film that changed the format of the screen musical forever. Award-winning film director Norman Jewison.
How can you not think of Michel Legrand and not think of Umbrellas of Cherbourg?
When my wife and I first saw The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, we were impressed by a number of things. One was the visual beauty of the film.
Lyricist for Fiddler on the Roof, Sheldon Harnick.
But it was the score that knocked us out. It was the tender moments and the yearning moments just hit us so deeply. It's something that Michel does better than almost any other composer. He invests the romantic music with such longing and such poignancy.
C'est la première fois que je reviens à Cherbourg depuis mon mariage. J'ai été chercher la petite chez ma belle-mère en Anjou. J'allais rentrer à Paris, puis j'ai fait ce détour. je ne pensais pas te rencontrer. Il a fallu ce hasard.
Michel Legrand brought a fresh voice at a time when film music itself was changing.
By the time he was 26, Legrand had found international acclaim with his groundbreaking album, Legrand Jazz, recorded in America with New York's foremost jazz musicians. But instead of staying there to build on his success, he returned home to Paris to work with the young experimental film director, Jacques Demy.
Tiens, qu'est-ce que c'est? C'est pour toi. C'est Roland qui te l'envoie. Mais je ne peux pas accepter. Fais ce que tu veux.
Jacques Demy was one of the directors of the New Wave, you know, in France.
Michel Legrand.
One day he brought me a script called The Infidelity or The Abraz of Cherbourg. I said, Jacques, I think that might be a musical. So we've started to write songs. Because for us, a musical was sung and spoken parts.
The Umbrellas of Cherbourg told the story of a young shop girl who becomes pregnant and eventually is forced to marry a man other than her baby's father. Although ideal material for a musical, Jacques Demy soon realized that the film would need a new approach for moviegoers of the 1960s.
And one day it comes to me and says, the passage between singing back to talking doesn't work. And he was right. The audience should read it completely the first time they hear it. Why don't we try, because it had never been done before, he said, why don't we try to be entirely songs?
No one had ever seen a movie like this where all of the dialogue was sung and all of the tunes were really special. These were melodies that soared in a way.
The theme was already ta-da-da-dee-da-da-dee-dee-dee. I said, what about that? He said to me, this is the exact style. I said, yeah. Perfect. That's exactly what it should be.
But even with a melody that would go on to become a modern standard, Legrand and Demy had to work hard to find financial backing for the film.
We spent a year auditioning in front of every possible person who has a little money to put in films. Big, small, medium producers. Nobody wanted it. Nobody. And they all said, you know, we don't believe that people are going to stay in a dark theater listening to people saying, how are you today? Did you have a little more salt in you? He said, that will never work. Forget it. I remember, you know, I was singing all the roles, and Jacques was there turning the page for me.
And Legrand was joined by his sister Christiane for a number of demonstration recordings of the score.
Demain, je pars à Amsterdam pour 3 mois. À mon retour, Geneviève vous me donnera elle-même sa réponse.
Je ne sais que vous dire.
Mais ne me dites rien. Geneviève décidera elle-même. Bonsoir, madame.
Bonsoir, monsieur Cassin.
And I started to hear behind me the producers doing.
But all was not lost, and originality eventually won through.
And we knew a very important man who owned newspapers, Pierre Lazareff. So we wrote him a long letter. 2 days later, a phone rings in my home. Legrand, Lazareff, yes. He says, okay, I don't know exactly what you want to do, but I have a very close friend of mine, a young lady who wants to become a producer. A young lady who knew nothing in films, but nothing at all. And he says, I want to help her, so she will produce your movie and I'll pay for it. Goodbye. And this is how we made the picture. And overnight it became a success in Paris.
No, I
just let someone with a deep love to give that deep love to you, and what magic you'll see. Let someone give his heart, someone who cares like me.
Tony Bennett's interpretation of Watch What Happens, one of the songs that originated in the Umbrellas of Cherbourg. Sheldon Harnick again.
Although the film may have been experimental and daring, it didn't look like that. It looked like it was done with such conviction and such authority.
And for many, the Umbrellas of Cherbourg made a lasting impression. Jazz pianist Terry Trotter.
The music works so beautifully with the film, and there's so many wonderful melodies there, and they underscored and intermingled with the film in such a natural way that I was completely enthralled.
When you first hear that score, I think it is true that many of the romantic numbers tend to sound like the same number. The more you become familiar with the score, the more individuality each number develops.
Norman Jewison again.
And I was so swept away with Umbrellas of Cherbourg. It was really a French musical. And there weren't too many musicals at that time, original, so romantic, that were being written specifically for the screen.
The Umbrellas of Cherbourg received 3 Academy Award nominations for Best Song, Best Score, and Best Adaptation Score. People were talking about that film, and while to this day I think people still sort of cock an eyebrow at The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, you know, does it really work? Is it as compelling as, you know, Legrand and Demy wanted it to be? But I tell you, you can't take issue with the quality of those songs. Watch What Happens, I Will Wait For You. These are indelible standards now that we all accept.
Well, it was a big success. I mean, you know, our company made millions of because of that. And luckily, those 2 songs became the standards in the state and still are, I mean, you know, today. But I didn't like the lyrics.
Well, Michel might not have liked Norman Gimbel's English lyrics, but they have been performed time and time again, such as Legrand's lavish 1997 arrangement of I Will Wait For You for Dutch vocalist Laura Fiji.
Anyway, you wonder. Anyway, you go. Every day, remember how I love you so. Away the hours one by one, and then the time will come when all the waiting's done. The time when you return and find me here and run straight to my waiting arms. If it takes forever, I will wait for you till you're back beside me, till I'm touching you, and forevermore, 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 I will wait for you.
Where does a melody line come from? Where does it come from?
Norman Jewison again.
All composers are influenced. You hear one composer, you kind of know they were influenced by Bach. They're all influenced by what has gone before. People say, well, it's mathematical, all music is mathematical. I don't hear any mathematics. I don't hear any of that in Michel. All I hear is melody.
Longtime Le Grand collaborator Marilyn Bergman.
Michel is certainly a brilliant melodist, there's no question. But I don't know that that doesn't limit a description of his music. I always know a melody of Michel's when I hear it, which also doesn't mean that there's a signature to his music. But there is, I guess it's style, you know. I mean, I know Mozart when I hear Mozart, and I know Bach when I hear Bach, and I know Michel Legrand when I hear him.
Terry Trotter.
When Michel Legrand writes a melody, he has a technique where he'll take a theme, and you can hear it in so many of his songs. I Will Wait For You. He'll take a theme and then he'll just develop.
He does write sequential melodies where there's this wonderful phrase or pattern that then builds and is embroidered upon, and then he takes to surprising places.
But he just moves it through all these keys and connects it in a way that it hangs together beautifully, and that's his gift.
Having the gift is one thing, but why have Legrand's songs endured? With over 200 scores to his name, much of his work has been composed for a specific moment in a film. But despite such original cinematic constraints, Michel Legrand's songs have survived.
The reason so many of his songs have become standards, where they actually can be taken out of the period in which they were written and still sound fresh and valid and musical, is because he has this gift for coming up with a melody that's not specific to the time.
Legendary jazz bassist Ron Carter.
Michel's work, they're the kind of songs with the accompanying lyrics that people can sing all the time. And because they're the kind of melodies that they are and the kind of lyrics that they are, you find a wide variety of people who sing them. I think when you have a writer who writes those kinds of melodies with or without accompanying lyrics, their music will always be around.
There's certain standards that you hear, and you realize that they still sound very much of the period in which they were written. His music isn't like that.
A lot of the music could have been written anytime, even tomorrow. I would be hard to put him in a century, even. Because just as there is something timeless about the music, so he is too.
Legendary singer Tony Bennett.
It's not like other composers where you hear one song and you say, that's got to be that composer, the same composer who wrote these songs. They all sound, there's just one style and that's it. No. Now, he takes chances. That's what's good about Michel. And the chances he takes become timeless.
Perhaps Legrand's film success was no surprise. After all, there has been a long tradition of French composers working in cinema, and the attraction for Legrand is a simple one.
French composers like Boris Ravel, Arthur Honegger, and many other classical composers, even Igor Stravinsky, they all wanted to work for movies for many reasons. First, it's very pleasant. It's very rewarding for fame and for money, too. I think the real reason is the film, to me anyway, the film gave me ideas, musical ideas, that I wouldn't have without the film.
Starring Catherine Deneuve and Nino Castelnuovo, Cherbourg was a box office hit and an international critical success. Its enduring appeal owing as much to its fresh, original score as to its experimental and daring approach.
After the success of Cherbourg, every producer asked us to do another one. Of course, we said, no, we did it once. Now, if we do something, we do something else.
But Jacques Demy and Michel Legrand did collaborate again on another French musical, and this time it was a tribute to Hollywood's golden age.
We are a pair. Before
for us so hard making every sacrifice, so that we should grow up with an IQ that's high. For our life has been full of potatoes to fry. Our papa was someone that no one talked about, but when we are naked, the awful truth comes out. In the small of the back, in the very same place, we've a big beauty spot. Papa had on his face. We are pale twins, born in the sign of Gemini. Ray, mi, fa, sol, re, do. Do, re, mi, fa, 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 do, si. We share the same young twin, giving the boys a bedroom key. Mi, fa, sol, la, mi, re. Ray, mi, fa, sol, 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 mi, mi.
Starring Catherine Deneuve and Françoise Dauriac, 1967's The Young Girls of Rochefort told a simple story of twin sisters looking for love.
Wanting to, with Academy, wanting to do The Young Girls of Rochefort was a little easier than wanting to do The Emperor of Cherbourg, because we had a big success a few years, you know, 3 years before. But it was not easy, because we wanted Jean Kelly. I said to Jacques Demy, I said, a musical in the American form cannot be done without Jean Kelly. I mean, he's a symbol of it. I mean, he's a prince, he's a king of it. So I said to Jacques Demy, I said, come with me. I took his hand, we flew to Los Angeles, we knocked at Jean's door. So we explained. And because he had medical exam, we had to wait 1 year from him. But you know, we waited with pleasure. We wanted Jean Kelly.
But even with Jean Kelly on board, the film didn't enjoy the critical reception of its predecessor. And some reviewers described it as being both embarrassing and naive. John Burlingame again.
I believe firmly that The Young Girls of Rochefort is a tremendously underrated film and a tremendously underrated score. In my view, the score improves upon the score for The Umbrellas of Cherbourg. I know that's heresy to a lot of people who truly value Cherbourg. Is the picture a piece of fluff? Well, I think that depends on how you define fluff. The fact is, Jacques Demy set out to make a kind of MGM musical with a French setting, where people are dancing in the streets. And, you know, a standard came out of that score, You Must Believe in Spring.
Je l'ai cherché partout, j'ai fait le tour du monde. De Venise à Java, de Mania encore. De Jeanne à Victoria, de Vénus en Joconde. Je ne l'ai pas trouvée et je la cherche encore. Est-elle loin d'ici? Est-elle près de moi? Je n'en sais rien encore, mais je sais qu'elle existe. Est-elle pécheresse ou bien fille de roi? Que m'importe son sang, puisque je suis artiste et que l'amour dicte sa loi.
Un joli portrait, mais je ne vois pas ça dans mon entourage.
Indeed, You Must Believe in Spring did become a standard, and there are many versions of the song by such notable artists as Cleo Lane, Freddie Cole, and Maureen McGovern. But as Jack Jones explains, as with much of Legrand's work, success doesn't mean simplicity.
The music that Michel Legrand writes is very challenging. Like You Must Believe in Spring, gorgeous song. But it's not easy to sing. It's not easy. It's not easy to learn.
Tony Bennett again.
He gravitates to the lyricists that are really saying something very well written, very talented people that really know how to write. It's all on the brink of poetry. You Must Believe in Spring. To me, that's a poem. It has such feeling, and it's so honest and so pure that I consider that an absolute poem. That's Ellen Marilyn Bergman.
You must believe in love and trust it's on its way. Just as the sleeping rose awaits the kiss of May. So in the world of snow, of things that certain of, you must believe in spring
that Rochefort is tremendously underrated. There are at least a half a dozen other tunes that deserve to be standards if only somebody had given them a chance. I think it's a great score.
By the end of the 60s, within France at least, Michel Legrand was the most successful film composer of his generation.
Jean-Luc Godard called me and said, Michel, I just finished a movie. I want you to score it. I said, no, Jean-Luc, no. Forget me. It's finished. I'm going to move. I want to go to Hollywood. I'm leaving. He said, no, please, before you leave, make said, no. Because, you know, I finished. I thought that I finished everything possible in the French cinema. So I wanted to try something else. Where? What? So I said, Hollywood.
Next week on The Music Never Ends, a game of chess, spinning wheels, and Henry Mancini.
I think Henry kind of put himself in Michel's shoes.
And for Michel Legrand, it's time to take no prisoners.
Why to be afraid? What could they say? No? So what?
I'm David Jacobs.
Of your life, I have only one request of your life, that you spend it all with me.
The Music Never Ends, The Michel Legrand Story, was written and produced by Malcolm Prince.